racing bicycles over cobblestones. It's said no one wins Paris-Roubaix without an enormous amount of suffering, and no one knows that better than American Jonathan Boyer. Boyer in the back of the pack on the left, Paris-Roubaix, 2 years ago. The cobbles had ripped his bike from beneath him, and the tumble left him in surgery. But Boyer, seen here training in Italy, has taken his spear and applied it in an almost foolhardy lust for danger. The personality fits for this American who at the age of 17 moved to Europe to train with the cycling masters and then to go on and become the first American to ride the Tour de France. Boyer carries a philosophy necessary to win a race like Paris-Roubaix.
Oh, I know I'm crazy, but it doesn't scare me, no. Kind of look forward to the fright and thrill of it.
For Greg LeMond, the responsibilities of family life preclude recklessness. But this proud father at 22 and reigning world champion still has designs on a crown he has never won as he prepares this day for a race he has never finished.
It's like winning Wimbledon in tennis or the U.S. Open. It's the biggest race, individual race in cycling.
It is hell. But everybody likes it. I'm even driven to like it.
It's pure pain.
Years ago, this classic moved its starting line just outside Paris to Compiègne, a town that has witnessed the surrender of French and German troops. And now each year, Compiègne attends the rites of spring in the world of cycling. Riders and their $3,000 machines pointed out of town on the way to Roubaix. Professional teams put together to work together, and with 160 miles of work ahead, no one claims victory alone. Outside Compiègne, the rain begins to fall, which only means the slippery cobblestones in the distance will enjoy more of what the riders fear. The roads are smooth for the first 60 miles, but when they narrow and the cobbles thicken, there is no room for company. And so begins the race to strike first at the stones. Itself is a study in discouragement for the weak at heart. When the riders leave Compiègne, they are teased with the facility of a comfortable ride. It's here where the team riders will block and draft for each other, trying to put their best riders into the cobbles first. The obstacles begin at mile 60 in Roubaix, and where the cobblestones begin to tug madly at the cyclists. By the time they reach Valenciennes, the bikes and the teams will begin to fall apart. But so far, the roads have been tame compared to what will soon be offered in the Arenberg Forest. At this point, more than 60 miles remain, and century-old cobblestones littered with potholes will find more prey. The velodrome in Roubaix and the finish seem so close now, but the last 30 miles are nothing but more bad roads and bad dreams. In the race now, and the pack of riders still strung along, testing each other with small breakaways. It's likely things will change before they hit Roubaix. Already the team support vehicles pressed into service, tire changes in 12 seconds, and the hardware nursed along by traveling pit crews. The favorite in this race, Irishman Sean Kelly, seventh place in July's Tour de France. American Jonathan Boyer, whose form, durability, and bravado have never been stronger. And of course, the blonde-haired, blue-eyed world champion, Greg LeMond. LeMond, who trains in Belgium, and whose meteoric rise has stunned the cycling world, He was forced to abandon this race twice, and he is hungry for this title. Blasting into the first set of cobblestones, a two-man breakaway, 1 minute ahead of the pack. Czeslaw Lang of Poland in the lead, and Rolf Hoffedetz of Denmark right behind him. But the rain found its way to Nouvelle before the riders. And what they thought would be a bumpy ride turned out to be slippery rocks steeped in mud. Many cyclists had reduced the pressure in their tires to ease the jarring impact on the stones, but now those fat tires with the thick mud and the scenic trip through France's northern nightmare had begun. Frenchman Jean-René Bernadot, his derailleur clogged, his support crew nowhere in sight. Lose a minute, two, then three, and to continue is pointless. And so these roads, fit for tractors and 17th century travelers, begin to chip away at the unlucky. Forty-one riders have not even made it halfway. Paris-Roubaix, bonne chance. Survivors, but still 80 long miles from Roubaix. Below, the sweeping, peaceful countryside, as benign as its narrow avenues are treacherous. The race has coursed through the streets of northern France since the late 1800s, and so anyone and everyone will wait, so Paris-Roubaix may continue. Still out front now, Lang and Hoffedetz, but from different teams and not working together. They begin to drop back towards the rest of the pack. And the riders entering Valenciennes, where after 90 miles of pedaling, they will take their supper and not break cadence as they consume it. Still others join the ranks of those who have now abandoned this race. The crowds expect it, and they seem to applaud it. To embrace the cobbles and refuse to yield, it is an honor to make it this far. And one shared now by the farmer's son from Tipperary, Ireland's Sean Kelly. His season of racing this year has been artful. And now, wearing the badge of filth, earned over almost 100 miles, he still appears strong. But his challenge will come from some of the very best. Alain Bondu, past world champion. Ahead of him, his domestique, working for him. Those who have survived are strong. Last year's winner, Henny Kuiper, with the experience to win again. American Greg LeMond, who's navigated the cobbles well this day. LeMond carries with him, though, the memories of two unfinished Paris-Roubaix races. And in the blue here, Jonathan Boyer has survived as well, who 2 years ago almost lost his nose in a headfirst crash on the cobbles. For those who race it and those who live with it, Paris-Roubaix is disturbing.
You know, because it's so dangerous. You just know you're going to come home bruised and swollen. get the first aid kit stocked up before the race starts. Yeah, please don't cry. Please don't cry.
American Greg LeMond, the world champion at age 22, on the roads to Roubaix, France. Their faces bear the expressionless stare of men who have met the cobblestone roads of the Paris-Roubaix bike race. Since 1896, they staged this classic here in the north of France, 160 miles from start to finish, known affectionately as the Hell of the North. It is the most grueling one-day bicycle race in the world. And although from above it would appear as just another bike race, those racers like Jonathan Boyer, who have been conquered by its perilous terrain, will tell you cobblestones can ruin your whole day. Well, Monsieur Boyer, as he is known here in France, is back again this year, as bold and as determined as ever. Racing for a rival team is another American in world champion Greg LeMond, wearing his world championship jersey. LeMond has had bad luck in this race previously. LeMond and Boyer join a list of ace European riders, including Irishman Sean Kelly. And while Kelly has asserted himself, this upstart American, LeMond, has been performing very well here, maintaining contact and avoiding the crashes in the cobbles. The race began outside Paris in Compiègne, with 157 riders, each on a high-speed hustle to shed the pack before the first cobblestones and the inevitable falls. And very soon, the cobblestones, the rain, and the mud forced more and more athletes to abandon the race. Broken rims, blown tires, and smashed kneecaps whittled the field as they found Valenciennes. So with 98 riders gone, a new challenge unfolds. The race now 4 hours old, and upcoming, the Arenberg Forest. Here, the cobblestones are legend. They are larger, more hazardous than the rest. And if you make it through the forest, your reward is another 60 miles to find the finish line in Roubaix. It is the Arenberg Forest that has caused even the best cyclists to curse the race organizers, toss their bicycles at team cars, and even refuse to ride this race ever again. The ride toward Arenberg and this year's engagement would prove no different. Straight through the forest and into a corridor mined with misfortune. If you're in front, you may make it through, but in the middle of the pack, and you're caught. This road is barely 12 feet wide. One crash can take out a whole pack. And there is no room for any support. With the team vans trapped, the riders must help each other. The final apocalypse in the forest reserved for the Renault team when 1983 Tour de France champion, blonde-haired Laurent Fignon, had to abandon the race. He and teammate Pascal Jules were caught in a fall. The fall left Jules wrenching in pain. But in the forest, the casualties move aside, and the race moves on. Disaster for the Renault team, a dejected Cyril Guimard, Renault team director. First his tour champion out, and now world champion Greg LeMond forced to drop from the Paris-Roubaix. A 2.5 mile forest avenue, and the field short another 11 cyclists. So now the thoughts of finding the finish line replaced by the search for a ride home. Race organizers provide the trip in a van, laced with the only touch of humor you'll see in this race.
Are you leaving now?
It's called the broom wagon. The cyclists who are swept from the course prefer its smooth trip home to the joke. Have become 48s. With this pack and a host of stragglers, they're strung out for miles. Off the front of the pack, the Frenchman Alain Bondu, a 1982 world champion, with support from his teammate Gregor Braun. As Bondu's domestique, or worker, Braun has been taking turns on the lead. If Bondu were to blow a tire, Braun would give him his own bike. In third place behind him is Kelly, who as one of the world's best sprinters is always within striking range, and his team has done a marvelous job moving him up. Team support is essential. You cannot win alone. Greg LeMond and his team and others were forced to quit after the Arenberg Forest.
Probably out of 60 riders, at least 30 of them went down, and I was one of them, so I lost 3 minutes coming out of there, and just wasn't worth it. I mean, I was too far. Trying to make 3 minutes up by myself is almost impossible.
And back on the road set the quintessential teamwork. Bondu and Braun continue their well-orchestrated work together, exchanging food and water. Looking for a Bondu victory is the task at hand. And what they cannot do for themselves, the team band can handle. Less than 50 miles to Roubaix, and it's still anyone's race. The shower room, next to the finish line in Roubaix. And the cast here is one of gloom for those whose ride to the finish came in a van. Now the time is spent removing the filth, along with the memories of an impossible task. And like the riders, their machines, dipped in mud, served up by the age-old cobblestones. But still miles from the finish, the survivors. Ireland's Sean Kelly and a handful of others beating back the cobblestones. But for the American Greg LeMond, the day ended miles from the finish line. LeMond says goodbye to Roubaix. And so too for American Jonathan Boyer.
When you lose contact with the front group, it's just no use keeping going. And I didn't want to hurt myself any more than I did.
Back out on the road, still in the lead, Alain Bondu, who has held this position almost since the very beginning. And now the mindset as he prepares for his finish. Behind him is Sean Kelly. Rudy Roger from Belgium. And with them, Bondu's domestique, Gregor Braun. Sean Kelly asserts himself, and the lead along the cobbles is now his. And the man who's been winning races all over Europe this year now looks for the most important win of his career. The pack of four quickly becomes three as Braun, the domestique, drops off the pace. Bondu tries to fight back and regain the lead. But then he bows to the cobblestones and goes down in a fall. The spectators run to his aid and get him back on his bicycle. He's back in the race. 3 miles from Roubaix, and 115 riders have already dropped out. Sean Kelly is in control. But Kelly is not alone. Right on his tail is Roger, the Belgian. The finish line begins. A little discussion, a glance maybe. A few words neither rider will ever remember. Bondu Sardou back on his bike, chasing madly. Kelly and Roger off the front. They close in on the velodrome, and Kelly checks for Bondu. And now the Frenchman's efforts to catch the leaders before the velodrome becomes frantic. Roger enters the velodrome first, Kelly right behind him. Almost 160 miles of torturous racing, and it will all be decided in one lap around this track. And now the race becomes psychological. Who will make the first move? 7 hours on the roads, and it's all come down to this. Then it happens. Roger makes the first move, and the question is, can the world's best sprinter and Sean Kelly catch him? Ben Kelly makes his move, goes high, checks over his shoulder for Roger, and Roger has nothing left. For Sean Kelly, the greatest victory of his career. And Kelly, never forgetting the images of the torturous ride over the relentless cobblestones of northern France. So now these cobbled roads, passageways to so much suffering and courage, enjoy another chapter in history. This race is over. The farmers have reclaimed their roads to market. Until in 1 year's time, the challenge will again be thrown down, and the cobblestone roads of France will become l'enfer du Nord, the hell of the North. I'm John Tesh.